Well, good morning on this beautiful Palm Sunday. We're excited to be here today, and we're excited and thankful that you're here with us also. Hopefully somebody handed you a worship guide as you came in the door a few moments ago, and you'll notice there's a tearaway tab there on the worship guide. And if you'd like to find out more about our Grace Life family, feel free to give us your contact information, and you can drop that into the offering plate later on as it comes around. You'll also notice there's some other opportunities there. Maybe you don't know the Lord, you've never trusted Jesus, and you'd like to know more about that. You can check that box there. You want to follow the Lord in believers' baptism? Let me know that so we can get with you and talk to you about that. Praise the Lord. We're baptizing people pretty much all the time here. We were in the lake last Wednesday night. We'll be in the lake again probably this Saturday. So if you would desire to follow the Lord in baptism, just give us your name and phone number, email address. We'd be happy to contact you. Or maybe you're interested in becoming a part of the Grace Life family. Our next Membership Matters class is on May the 4th. You can just check that box that you want to join Grace Life, and we'll be happy to contact you and get all the information to you that you need about that. Opportunities there to help with Vacation Bible School. You can communicate that to us as well. Or maybe you have a prayer need today in your life that you just want to share with the pastors here. Feel free to write that in. We don't publicize those unless you ask us to. We don't put those in our prayer list. It's just our pastors pray over those during the course of this week. And also, if you're part of our Grace Life family and it wasn't possible for you to be in Sunday school in the last hour, if you would just let us know that you're here today, just put your name on there and drop that in the plate later on as it comes around. We'll be grateful for that. A lot of you probably already spent some time in the fireside room today. I just finished getting my shoes shined in there. Our little boys, our RA boys, elementary school age guys, they're in there shining shoes. And our GAs, our little girls, elementary school age girls, they're in there doing a bake sale. And all the proceeds from those two events are going to our new ministry at Grace Life called Grace Life for Orphans. I'm not sure that there's going to be anything left in there by the time we're out of this service. So if you didn't go by there already, you might want to bail out now and go, because I think stuff's going pretty fast. Also in there, and this is going fast too, and this is a great thing, we're doing a food drive for a ministry here in Birmingham called Well House. Well House is a great organization doing great work in our city. And the food drive that we're doing is you can go out there by the fireplace. We have a display set up. Different food items are sitting there with a sign-up sheet. So, for example, you can commit yourself to the jelly, all right? And they're asking for 12 jars of jelly, for example, and you need to have that here by sometime in May. I forget the exact date. But if you haven't done that already, stop by there on your way out today. Chances are everything's going to be already volunteered for, but there's still maybe a few items left, and we'd love for you to finish that off for us. Don't forget, a big week this week at Grace Life. Of course, Wednesday night's church, as always, but Thursday night is our Maundy Thursday service. It's at 7 o'clock, very special service. We're going to be celebrating the Lord's Supper together on Thursday night. Friday night at 7 o'clock is our Good Friday service, really celebrating the cross and Jesus' finished work on the cross for us. Saturday is our Easter egg hunt out at Shadow Lake with two hunts, one at 11, one at 1, and lunch in between at noon. So if you come earlier, come late, be sure to come in between so you get lunch there with us as well. And then Easter Sunday in this room a week from today, two services, 8 o'clock and 10:45. Little change on our schedule, okay? 8 o'clock and 10:45, and no Sunday school. So we look forward to all that God has in store for us this week. But hey, we're here today. I'm looking forward to what God has in store for us today. Amen? Well, let's stand together. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Father, we do praise you, God, for the beautiful day that you've given us today. We recognize this as Palm Sunday. We're reminded that it was on this day 2,000 years ago that Jesus, you rode into Jerusalem on a donkey, that you were headed to your mission to give your life on the cross for us in our place. And we stand in awe once again today of your great grace and mercy for us. Thank you that you've brought us together on this day to worship you. We're just reminded again, as always, that this is not how we wrap up our week. This is not the weekend. This is the beginning of the week. This is the first day of this week. And I am grateful that we get to start our week off like this. I can't think of a better way. And I pray that we would engaged fully in this time of worship, that you would have our mind's attention and our heart's affection today, and that your Holy Spirit would move in our hearts and move in this place and touch lives and change us and transform us today for your glory and for our joy. And we ask all of this in Jesus' good name. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Well, meet somebody this morning and welcome one another today, and let's worship the Lord together. Thank you.
forever praise you. Faithful God. Sing this chorus together, church. Faithful God, you reign forever. Sing.
Faithful God, you reign forever. We will hope in your great name. Strong and mighty King of heaven, we will worship you, O faithful God.
Faithful God. We sing this song, we say the words King of heaven. Because we don't just worship a kingdom that's here on this earth, we worship a king of a kingdom that's in heaven that exists forever, for all of eternity. And we sing that we will ever praise him because of what Jesus did, because we have access to God now because of, because when the curtain was torn in two, all of a sudden we don't have to go through a high priest. Jesus is the high priest, and so we can worship him for all eternity. And do you know that right now, just as we're worshiping God on the earth, that there is worship going on in heaven, in the kingdom of God right now. They're singing about God's holiness right now. Just as we're singing about his holiness and his faithfulness right now, there's worship going on right now. And that's what this next song is talking about. It's talking about turning our ears to heaven and hearing the noise inside, hearing the worship that's going on inside. We want to just worship him on this earth, in this place right now. Let's sing together.
Turn your ear to heaven and hear the noise inside, the sound of angels, all the sound of angels' songs, and all this for a king. We could join and sing all for Christ our King. Song of ours will rise. Oh, how constant our infinitely sweet, this great love that has redeemed, as one we sing. Oh, praise Him, oh, praise Him, He is holy, He is holy, yeah. Oh, praise Him, oh, praise Him, He is holy, He is holy, yeah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, He is holy.
That this morning. We praise You. Lord, we help us to put our trust in You. Help us to know Your greatness so well that we know that our inheritance is not what we accumulate here in this earth, Father, but our treasure, the treasure of our hearts is in You. Lord, may we be found in You and in Your righteousness. To always bear in mind that this is not our home, that we have a Heavenly Father that will one day call us home to be with Him. God, we worship You. Help us now in this moment to sing and to shout and to praise the God of all eternity. You are worthy of our praise this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's sing this together.
Silver, gold, or anything I could own compares to You, compares to You. What is fame and success?
I want to invite Joshua Brady Gamble to bring his family up here. And he's doing a good job already. And what a special treat today is. This is Brandon, my brother, and Adriana, my sister. And this is Brady. And we're praying today he's going to be my future brother in the Lord and part of God's family and the kingdom of God. And what a thrill it is. Brandon and Adriana have been such a blessing to our Grace Life family. We just praise God for you guys. And Brandon's got a call in his life into ministry and loves the Lord and loves his word. And Adriana has such a precious heart for God. And it's a special family that God's got his hand on and setting them apart for special work in God's kingdom. And we call this a baby dedication. But obviously, today really we're dedicating ourselves. First and foremost with you, Brandon. God's called you not just to be a pastor in general, but to be the pastor specifically, first and foremost, to Adriana and to Joshua Brady and to any other children that God may bless you with. You're to be the pastor, the priest, and the leader of your home. And I know that you're striving to be that, man. And we pray for you and praise God for that. And Adriana, same for you, dedicating yourself today to be that heart of this home. Brandon may be the head, but definitely God has equipped and called women, I think, to be the heart of the home, to bring things into that home that God has uniquely equipped you to be able to do, to be a blessing to Brady. And we're all committing ourselves today, dedicating ourselves today, that as his family and as his church family, we want to be found faithful before the Lord, that everything that we do and say would lead Brady one day to a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Man, what a day that's going to be, brother. Amen. And I know we're already praying about that. So we're going to pray together for this family and for Brady, but I want to invite y'all's family to come join you on the platform. I know families are always like, oh no, do I really have to go there? We really would like for you to. If you're a part of this family, would you come just stand with Brady today? Y'all just come on up. Come on up, come on up. And join us here, and we're just going to circle around y'all. Our church family is going to be standing. Y'all go ahead, church family, and stand. We're all going to stand together for Brady today, that he'd come to know Jesus one day as his Savior and Lord, and pray for ourselves that we would do nothing but point him in that direction. Let's see, I want to get my hands on him. Hey, buddy, remember me? He's gotten bigger since last time I held him. Yeah. All right. Church, this is Brady. We praise God for him, and let's pray together for him. Father God, we are so grateful to get to stand here today. As we look at Brady, Lord, we see your fingerprints all over him. He is uniquely and wonderfully made, and you made him. There's no doubt about that. Lord, we thank you for his family. We thank you for Brandon, Lord, for the man of God that he's striving to be, for Adriana, God, for the woman of God that she's striving to be. And Lord, we pray, God, for this family, that you, by your grace, would continue to set them apart, to be a display in this world of what a family is all about, to be a display of your glory, God, that people would see Jesus in them. God, we pray for extended family today. We pray for our church family. Lord, what a solemn responsibility we have given ourselves to. We have made this promise to care for those under our care and to raise them in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. And so we join together with this family today in this holy responsibility of pointing Brady Gamble to the Lord Jesus Christ. God, by your grace, would you help us to do that? And God, we do ask that as soon as possible, your Holy Spirit would work in his heart. You would show him his sinfulness and show him the hope that he has in the Lord Jesus, that he would repent of his sin and trust Jesus alone to save him, and that then he would follow you all the days of his life, that he would grow to be a world changer for the glory of God. We ask you to do all of this in the strong and mighty name of the only one who saves, your Son, our Savior Jesus. Amen. Amen. Look, you're going to make a good church member. You're already sleeping on Sunday. You know how it's done. I'm going to hand you back to Mom here, and I got something for you guys. Got a Bible here. It's first study Bible. The notes are really, really small in there, and a certificate for you guys. You guys praise the Lord for this family and be praying for them in the days ahead. God bless you guys. Love y'all. Your brother. Love you, man. All right. No, you can't preach today. Go sit down. Amen. Brother Barry, you come pray for us, sir.
Would you pray with me? Father, we stand before you with grateful hearts this morning for this wonderful, beautiful Palm Sunday you've brought us. As we go into this week, into this service, would you just allow us to turn our hearts and eyes to you, that we'll just focus on you only. Would this be a time of praise and a time of reflection? Father, as we take up this offering, may we give generously and with a joyful heart. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Have you ever wondered why we refer to the day Christ died as Good Friday? Seems somewhat strange, doesn't it? I mean, Friday is the day that he who was celebrated had become despised. He who was innocent was punished like the guilty. He who was the lion was slaughtered like a lamb. That doesn't seem good. And consider the Pharisees and their motives. For them, it was a premeditated murder, though it was actually a predestined sacrifice. They thought they were taking his life, though he was in fact surrendering it. Death was their goal, yet life was the outcome. Because God had other plans, he made one day affect all of eternity. He turned the wounds of one into healing for many. He transformed our worst acts of hate into the greatest expression of love. So that at the cross, we can hand over our sins in exchange for righteousness. We can lay down our burdens and pick up freedom. We can come broken, yet leave restored. The enemy thought it was going to be a bad day. We now call it good. And though we all thought it was the end, it was actually just the beginning. It seems God has a way of rescuing us from ourselves and flipping things around. Maybe that's why we call it Good Friday.
If you have a Bible this morning, I invite you to turn to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23. Luke, chapter 23, and today is our last week in our series that we've been in called Any Last Words, as we've looked at the final words, the final sayings of Jesus from the cross. And today, really, there's no way around it. Today's sermon, in a lot of ways, for me at least, I think is going to feel like a funeral, which is not unusual to be preaching a funeral. Unfortunately, I have to preach lots of funerals, but to feel like I'm preaching a funeral on a Sunday is highly unusual, because Sunday, for me, is always a day of celebration. It's always a day of rejoicing. Every Sunday is Resurrection Sunday, not just Easter Sunday, but every Sunday is Resurrection Sunday, because Sunday was the day of the week that our Lord Jesus was raised from the dead. And the early church, they shifted over 1,000 years of worshiping on Saturday after Jesus rose from the dead. They shifted it to Sunday. Just proof that something God-sized had to happen for them to change tradition in such a dramatic way, to move worship from this Sabbath day, this holy day on Saturday, to move it to Sunday. And so that's why we worship together on Sundays. The Church of Jesus Christ has been worshiping on Sundays soon after His resurrection from the dead. And so every Sunday we gather, we are proclaiming and we are celebrating He's alive. Jesus has risen. He has conquered death and He has conquered the grave. But today, as we come to this very last thing that Jesus said on the cross, we recognize today He's about to die. He's about to breathe His very last. And next Sunday will be a day of celebration. Again, for sure, it's going to be Easter Sunday, so we're going to just celebrate twice as hard as we're celebrating today. So I hope you'll be here for that next week. But today we come to Luke chapter 23, verse 46. Look at that with me. Verse 46 of Luke chapter 23. And Jesus called out with a loud voice. Now that's unusual. I've been with people when they said their final words. I've been with a lot of people when they took their last breath, maybe more than anybody else in this room. I've been in that place, and I've never heard anybody raise their voice in that moment. I've never heard anybody speak loudly in that moment. I've never heard anybody shout in that moment. Usually, if they can say anything at all, it's a whisper. And sometimes you just kind of have to be good at even reading their lips when they come to that last and final moment. But Jesus here, He proclaims this with a loud voice. This is just another one of the reasons I think that maybe the centurion soldier would declare after this, surely this was the Son of God. Because ordinary people don't die like this man is dying. Ordinary people don't die asking God to forgive their enemies. Ordinary people don't die in that sort of way. Ordinary people are not shouting victory cries from the cross. And so very unique. It says Jesus called out with a loud voice. And here's the phrase we're going to really focus in on today. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And when He said this, He breathed His last. Let's pray. Father, we stand in awe today as we have stood at the foot of the cross now for 7 weeks and heard these final statements of Jesus from the cross, and You stirred our hearts all along the way, and this one's heavy, but You know this one is the last one that He said as He hung there in our place. And we pray that You would take the truth, the magnitude of this phrase, and You would embed it deep in our hearts and souls, and that Holy Spirit today, You would use it to change us and have Your will in this place today, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, one thing that I've kind of come away with out of this sermon series is that not only has Jesus taught us how to live, but He's also taught us how to die. We don't like to think of that very often. None of us like to think about death. But the reality is Jesus modeled for us in so many ways how to really die. And I believe you can't really live until you're ready to die. You're never ready to live until you're first ready to die. And Jesus was ready to die. And He dies in a way that leaves us some tremendous examples. He knew it was His time to die. He didn't fight it. He wasn't bitter here. He's not lashing out. If anybody had a right to lash out in their death, certainly it would have been Jesus, the perfect one, the sinless one, being treated the way that He was being treated. But He's not lashing out. He's not angry. He's not bitter. He's not complaining. He is peaceful. He knows where He's going. He knows that He's not left any unfinished business. He's already declared it is finished. He is at peace with God. He is at peace with Himself, and He is trusting God for His future. Now, how did He show us how to die? That's what I want to talk about this morning. What do you need to know when you're facing death? And hey, let me just tell you the honest truth this morning. You are facing death. Every person in this room is facing death. Some of you are facing it maybe in a more real way than somebody else because somebody's put a time frame now on your life. They've said months or maybe a couple of years. Maybe they've said that to you, but even if you haven't said that to, nobody has said that to you, you're still facing death. You just may not remember that you are. You may not want to admit that you are. Like those high school seniors up in the Northwest who were on the bus headed to a college campus this past week, all they could think about was the future. All they thought they were facing was the future. Where am I going to go to school? And what am I going to study? And who am I going to meet there? And is my future husband going to be there? Is my future wife going to be there? And what fraternity or sorority am I going to be? How am I going to use my time? And are there going to be job opportunities that are there? And then suddenly there's a collision. And the bus is in flames. And 10 young people die on a day when all they could think about was their future. Listen, I want you to think about the future, but I don't want you to ever forget we're all facing death. Every single one of us is going to die unless the Lord Jesus returns before then, and I pray that He will, but we need to be living in the constant reality of the fact that death is on its way. And Jesus showed us, number one, that when facing death, like we're facing it today, He showed us that there's a person to know. There's a person to know as you're facing death. I hope that you know this person. Jesus starts off with this wonderful word right here. He says, Father. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Now let me remind you that He has not been referring to God as His Father as He's hung there on the cross. Do you remember that? You remember they crucified Him at 9. It goes dark at noon. He cries out 3 hours later at 3 o'clock. My God, why have you forsaken me? He could no longer call out to Him as His Father. Why? Blow your mind. Because in the darkness, Jesus became God's enemy. True story. Because He took your place in my place. And the Bible makes it clear we were the enemies of God. But Jesus substituted Himself in your place and my place, therefore becoming, in that moment of darkness, God's enemy. In that darkness, it was not that God had left Him. No, God turned on Him. God didn't turn away from Him. God turned on His Son. He crushed Him. The Old Testament says it pleased the Lord to crush Him. In that dark moment, those dark 3 hours, God was pouring out His wrath on Jesus. He was pouring out His anger on Jesus. He was punishing Jesus for your sin and for my sin. And Jesus could not call God Father in those moments. But when 3 o'clock comes and the darkness lifts and the penalty has been paid, the wrath has been poured out, Jesus has endured the full punishment for all the sin of the world. The substitutionary act of atonement now has been accomplished. Now restoration between Father and Son is happening. Reconciliation is happening. He's already declared it is finished. His sacrificial death on the cross has been finished. Now there is this reunion in this final moment on the cross of God the Father and God the Son now coming back together after an eternity's worth of hell was compressed upon Jesus for 3 hours. Now they come back together in a restored relationship and Jesus calls Him Father. Listen, I hope you can call Him Father today. The only way you can call Him Father is the same way that Jesus called Him Father. You have to be restored to Him. You have to be reconciled to Him. You have to be in a right relationship with Him. And the only way that happens is not by being religious. It only happens through a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. You cannot be reconciled to God any other way. You cannot have your broken relationship with God restored any other way except by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. And I hope today that beyond a shadow of a doubt, you know that your relationship with Almighty God has been reconciled. It has been restored through the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross, and that you can call God your Father. Jesus shows us that when facing death, there is a person that you need to know. And I hope today, as you're facing death, you know God as your Father. And I want you to know this morning, whether you do or whether you don't know Him as your Father, you need to know what kind of Father He is. Because when you say Father, some people get a little wigged out. They get a little freaked out. Makes them a little nervous. Because your Father experience on earth hasn't been a good experience. Your Father has failed. He hasn't been there. He's harmed you. He's hurt you. He's forsaken you. Maybe he's abandoned you, but that's not the daddy we're talking about this morning. We're talking about a heavenly father. I want you to know this morning that our heavenly father is a loving father. He is a loving father. In other words, he's close to us. He's not distant. He's not aloof. He's not abandoned you. He's close. Not only is he close, but he's consistent. He's not moody. He's not fickle. Maybe some of you grew up with a dad like that. When you came home, you never knew, is he going to be the drunk, angry dad? The hurtful, harmful dad? Or is he going to be the sappy dad? I don't know what I'm going to get today when I walk in the house with dad, but I want you to know Heavenly Father is not only close, but he's consistent. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's also our competent father. He's fully able to handle anything that's going on in your world, fully able to handle anything that's going on in your life. He's close and he's consistent and he's competent and he's caring. He's caring. He's compassionate. He cares about you. Look, let's be honest. Let's be clear. Real simple. There's nobody in all the world that loves you like God loves you. There's nobody that cares for you like your Heavenly Father cares for you. He cares about everything that's going on in your life. And for some of you this morning, it may be good news to know that he sees everything that's going on in your life. For some of you, that's bad news because you don't want him to be seeing. But he does. He cares about it all. And he sees it all. And he has the power to work in it all. Whatever it is that's going in your life, he has the power to work out his plan in your life. And by the way, his plan for your life is infinitely better than your plan for your life. He knows best. He cares best. He loves us more than you can imagine. The Bible says in Psalm chapter 103, listen, it says, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who honor him. As fathers, like me, have compassion on our children, so God has compassion on us. I love it when Jesus said, if earthly fathers who are sinners know how to give good gifts to their kids, how much more does your Father in heaven, who is perfect, know how to give good gifts? Because look, I try to be a good daddy, but I mess up. I'm not a perfect human being by any stretch of the imagination. And I mess up and I bomb and I fail. And Jesus says, but as much as you're giving good gifts to your kids, you just think about the Heavenly Father who never messes up in the way he loves his kids. He never misses that opportunity. He never bombs out. And it's tough, man. It's tough being a dad, right? I know y'all like to hear my Elijah stories. Elijah's 5, and I've got about a year and a half left that I can tell Elijah stories, and then he's going to be sitting in here in big church. And if he's like his older brother and sister, he will tell me the same thing they told me, Dad, please don't talk about us in church. So I got a year and a half left that I get to talk about Elijah in church, but you guys can't go tell him. The last time I told one of those stories about the football game, y'all remember that story when he got a tail whooping in the bathroom at Bryant-Denny Stadium? Y'all remember that? Oh, yeah, now you remember. Y'all weren't supposed to go tell him that. We left church that day. We're going home, and he said, Dad, everybody at church today knew that I went to the football game yesterday. Isn't that weird? All right, so look, here's our deal. I'll keep telling y'all Elijah stories if y'all won't go tell him what we talked about. So a couple of days ago, we're out in the yard, in the front yard, and the house across the street from us, it burned down a while back, and it's just an empty lot over there. And the neighborhood kids have kind of turned that into the sand lot. That's where they all hang out. That's where they play. And Elijah's in the yard with me, and there's three big guys over there playing. I mean, they're like every bit of 6, maybe 7 even. And I could tell just watching Elijah, he just kept watching them, and he's kind of listening to them. And I could tell, you know, he wants a piece of that action over there. And I said, hey, do you want to go over there and play? And he didn't know these kids. And I said, do you want to go over there and play? You know, because he's little. He hadn't really got outside the yard a whole lot. And he said, can I? And I said, yeah, man, you can. So he starts to go over there. He's got on his Crocs. You know the shoes I'm talking about, the Crocs? And he has them on the wrong feet. He does that all the time. And I'll say, Elijah, your shoes are on the wrong feet. And his answer always is, I like them that way. Okay. But here's how I know my little man's growing up. Some big boys are across the street. He's about to go play with them. He starts to walk across the street. He looks down at his feet. He sees his feet looking like this. He stops. He puts them on the right feet. Because nobody but nobody, especially no 6-year-old, has any business making fun of that. I don't know how to wear my shoes on the right feet, even if I do like them. So he goes over there. He has a blast. So yesterday, we're back out in the yard most of the day, just piddling, working, whatever we're doing. and he wants to go back down the street and play with his buddies. They're down at their house this day, so he wants to go down. He's asking me all day, Dad, can I go down there? When can I go down there? Can I go down there? Can I go down there? All day long. Elijah, I don't know, buddy. I don't know. Not right now. Dad's busy. Because I'm not comfortable. He's only five. I'm not comfortable just letting him walk a couple of houses down. I mean, I know he's my third one, and maybe I'm not supposed to care anymore, but weird thing, I still care, you know? And we got some crazy dogs, and we've had coyotes in our backyard recently, and there's just crazy people in the world. And so until I can walk him down there, I can't let him go. I got issues, I'm sure. So anyway, all day long, that's all I hear. We eat dinner last night, and I'm ready just to start studying for today a little bit and kick back and chill. And I can just—he's just down. He didn't get to go. He didn't get to go play today. And he's asked me only a million times. And so there's still some daylight out. And I looked out the window. I could see the kids down there in their yard. And so I said, "Hey, Elijah." Oh, and by the way, when he walked across the street the other day to play with him, they go, "Hey, what's your name?" He goes, "I'm Eli." He's never been Eli. It's always been Elijah. I'm like, dude is too cool for school. Got his shoes on the right feet, changing his name. I mean, good gracious. So, hey, Eli, you want to walk down to the neighbor's house and play? And he said, can I? And I said, yeah, if you want to. Oh, yeah. And so he comes running out the front door, and he stops, puts his arm around. He said, Dad, you're the best. I went, oh, yes, the best. And the reality is I'm nowhere near the best, and I hope as dads we're trying to be the best for our kids, but we're not the best, but we have the best, and he is in heaven. He is our Heavenly Father, and he is the best. He has compassion on his children. Jesus is showing us that when we're facing death, there's a person to know. He's a loving Father, but not only is he a loving Father, he's a trustworthy Father. One of the greatest questions that we have to answer in life is, who are you going to trust? See, who you trust is going to determine whether you fail or succeed. Who you trust in life is going to determine if you make something out of yourself or if you just waste your life. Who you trust is going to determine whether or not your life finds fulfillment or remains empty. And so we all have to figure out, who am I trusting in this world? I mean, thank the Lord we have government to trust, right? Okay, we're praying for government, but we're not trusting them, amen? But at least we have the media. We can all trust the media, right? Nobody's trusting the media. Well, public opinion, because we, you know, over 300 million Americans in this country, and they all got their act together. So whatever they say, we got to trust that, right? We're all on board with that. We trust, no? So we trust ourselves. If I can trust anybody, I know I can trust myself, right? I see some of y'all going, ain't no way. Some of you have lived just long enough to finally get honest and go, I trusted myself once, blew it, in a ditch. Just messed up, no good. That ain't working. We can't even trust ourselves. Our emotions will lead us astray, right? People say, I'm going to go with my gut. That's dumb. Your gut could be responding to the movie it just watched or to the burrito you ate last night. Not a real stable factor in your life to go with your gut. Well, I'm just going to follow my heart. The Bible says, above all else, the heart is deceitfully wicked. Why are you going to follow the thing that is more wicked than anything else on planet Earth? So we can't trust the government. We can't trust the media. We can't trust the folks around us. We can't even trust ourselves. When you start trying to figure out who is it you're going to trust, you better choose someone, A, that has your best interest at heart. That's not looking out for themselves. They really are looking out for you. Secondly, not only must they be somebody that's looking out for you, but they need to be somebody that's perfect. That's perfect. Not only must they be looking out for you, and not only must they be perfect, but they need to know everything. Because I don't want to trust somebody that doesn't know how it's going to turn out, right? So you trust somebody that's looking out for you, you trust somebody that's perfect, you trust somebody that knows everything, and you trust somebody that has no deception in them whatsoever. Would you agree with me? We just narrowed it down to God. There's only one who is trustworthy, who is worthy of our trust. And it is our Heavenly Father. Jesus says, I want you to know when you're facing death, there's a person to know. He's a loving Father. And He's a trustworthy Father. He says, into your hands I commit my spirit. To commit there means to entrust or to deposit, kind of like you would a safety deposit box, right? You got that little special thing that's been passed down through your family, or you got your prized baseball card or piece of jewelry or whatever it is, that document, and you want to make sure thieves can't get to it or floods can't get to it or fire can't get to it. So you take it down here to the bank and you get a safety deposit box and you deposit that into that. You're saying, I put my trust in this organization to keep this precious thing safe. That's the same language Jesus was using when He said, Father, into your hands I deposit my spirit. I trust you with everything about my life that's left now. What's most important is my spirit, because God is a trustworthy God. So let me ask you this question. What do you need to entrust to God today? What have you not been trusting God with today? And let me help you answer that question real simple. What are you worrying about? Because whatever you're worrying about is what you need to be trusting God with. See, because when we worry, what we're really saying is, I don't believe in God. When you worry, you're a practical atheist. You're saying, I don't believe God. I don't believe God's going to come through. I don't believe God's watching. I don't believe God cares about me. You try to figure out, what is it that I need to deposit with God today? It's whatever that thing is in your life that you're all worried about. The antidote to worry is trust. You want to stop worrying about something? Give it to God. Give it to God. Today, God, I don't want to worry about this anymore. I can't change a thing by worrying about it. I'm just wasting my energy and time worrying about it. God, I'm going to trust you fully. See, Jesus said, even when you're facing death, there's a person to know, our Heavenly Father, and He is loving and He is worthy of your trust, even with death on the horizon. And don't forget, every single one of us has death on the horizon. It's there, and we can't get away from it. I think some of the times when it's hardest to trust God, tell me if I'm right or wrong, it's hardest to trust God not when things are easy, but when things are hard. Am I right? Isn't it more hard? Isn't it? That's an Alabama word. Isn't it? It's more hard to trust God in painful times than in times of great comfort and ease. Am I right? I mean, that's the whole backdrop of the story of Job. Satan goes to heaven. He says to God, God says, have you checked out Job? And he's the man. And the devil says to God, the only reason he's the man is because you've made him your pet. You've done nothing but good for him. He's living this really sheltered, pampered sort of life. But if you start peeling all that back and you strip all that away, take it away from him, he's going to turn on you, God. Because Satan knows it's easier to trust God when it's all going your way. It's harder to trust God in the pain and in the suffering. But that's where we grow in our faith. Turn with me to 2 Timothy chapter 1. You got to do a little Bible study with me today. And maybe Brian will hook you up with some scriptures on the back there for those of you who need a little extra help. 2 Timothy chapter 1. You talk about suffering. I don't think we've ever had anybody that ever suffered more in their following Jesus than our brother Paul, the Apostle Paul. I mean, I take my little whiny list and compare it next to Paul's resume, and I'm like, man, what in the world am I whining about? Come on, my gracious. Paul in 2 Timothy is writing from a prison. And he writes in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12, that is why I'm suffering as I am. He's not trying to candy coat it. He's telling us, man, I'm suffering, I'm hurting, there's pain in my life. Yet, this is no cause for shame, because I know whom I have believed. I know who I've trusted in. I know that I have a Heavenly Father who is trustworthy, even in my pain, and I am convinced. Paul says, I am convinced in my pain and my suffering, I am convinced that He is able. Let me ask you this morning, are you convinced in the middle of your pain that God is able? Are you convinced in the middle of your pain this morning that God is able? Paul said, I am convinced that He is able to do what? He's able to guard what I've entrusted to Him until that day. In other words, Paul says, what I have given to him, what I have trusted him with, I don't have to worry about it anymore. I've trusted him with it. It belongs to him now. It's not mine to own anymore. I don't have to worry about it anymore. I don't have to deal with it anymore. I trust him and I know he is able. Jesus would have you know this morning, because you're facing death, there's a person to know, and he is your heavenly Father who loves you like nobody's business and who is the only one in all the universe who is trustworthy. Secondly, Jesus wants you to know this morning that when you're facing death, there's a place to rest. When you're facing death, there's a place to rest. Jesus said, Father, that's the person, into your hands. That's the place to rest. The hands of God. The hands of God. He said, into your hands, I commit my spirit. In other words, he was saying, I know that I'm in good hands. People have been using that language now for a long time, right? Now we got the Allstate commercial. You're in good hands. With all, in other words, you can trust them, right? They're going to be there for you when mayhem happens. Do you love the mayhem commercials? Love the mayhem commercials. I like the one especially, he's the cleaning lady at the top of the steps and he falls backwards. I don't know if you noticed this. When he gets to the bottom, his arm is twisted all the way around. It's sick. Check it out and YouTube it today when you get home. Because mayhem happens. Listen, Christians aren't exempt from mayhem happening. Mayhem is going to happen. But I want to tell you this morning, as good a company as Allstate may or may not be, I don't know, the hands that I hope you know you're in are the hands of God. That's the place to find rest. Not in a person, not in an organization, but in the hands of your heavenly Father. I want you to know this morning that his hands are big enough to carry you. The hands of God are big enough to carry me. You remember that great hymn of the faith we used to sing a long time ago? I mean, the piano and the organ would be so strong, and the church would stand up and we would sing, he's got the whole world in his hands. Remember that? Whole world. He's got the whole world. He's got the whole world in his hands. Awesome song. A lot of truth. When you go to Colossians chapter 1, you read that he holds all things together. He really does have the whole world in his hands. Here's good news. That means if he can hold all this stuff together, I'm no problem. His hands are big enough to carry me. Not only are the hands of God big enough to carry me, but see, secondly, the hands of God are scarred enough to remember me. They're scarred enough to remember me. Now in heaven, I don't think our bodies are going to have any scars. I don't think we're going to have any wounds. I don't think we're going to have any more deformities. I think we're going to have this perfect body. But there's going to be one person in heaven that's still going to have scars. I believe Jesus is still going to have those scars in heaven as a reminder of how much he loves you and as a reminder of how much he loves me. Really cool verse I want to show you, Isaiah chapter 49. Go to the Old Testament with me. Isaiah chapter 49, maybe we'll throw it up there for you, starting in verse 13. In Isaiah chapter 49, people call Isaiah the fifth gospel because Isaiah is all about Jesus. In fact, the whole Bible is all about Jesus. If you didn't know that, it's true. It's Jesus from Genesis 1. It's Jesus all the way through the end of Revelation. It's Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I prayed about even preaching that on next Sunday for Easter. I hadn't really made up my mind yet because I just love talking about that it's all about Jesus. And Isaiah chapter 49 is no exemption to that. It's Jesus here. In fact, it's Jesus speaking, I believe, in Isaiah chapter 49. It's the Lord, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, which is Yahweh. And I'm clearly convinced that that is none other than Jesus. So here it is, Isaiah 49:13. Shout for joy, you heavens. Rejoice, you earth. Burst into song, you mountains. Why? For Yahweh comforts his people and will have compassion on his afflicted ones. But Zion said, this is the people of God, Zion. They said, Yahweh has forsaken me and Adonai has forgotten me. Some of you have said the very same thing. God blew it. He left me. He abandoned me. He didn't come through. God comes back, Yahweh comes back in verse 15. He says, can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she has born? Though she may forget, I will not forget you. God says, I will not forget you. And watch this, verse 16. See, I have engraved you on the palms of my hands. This is Yahweh, Jesus, speaking out of Isaiah chapter 49, and he says, I have engraved you on the palm of my hands. This was 1,000 years before Jesus was crucified, and yet he was already saying what was going to happen. Watch Evan say Jesus over here. You see what she did? Why do we sign Jesus like that? Because we're saying he has scars in his hands. His hands are scarred enough to never forget you. Scarred enough to always remember you. His hands are big enough to carry you. They're scarred enough to always remember you. And thirdly, the hands of God are strong enough to keep you. They're strong enough to keep you. Now Elijah, he's five, and he's a big kid and getting bigger by the minute. But he's still cool because my older two kids, they never have liked to snuggle a lot. I like to snuggle with my kids. Elijah likes to snuggle. So he's my boy. So we like to snuggle. And he ends up in our bed a lot to his mother's dismay. I couldn't really care. We went to Generations Camp. He and I both slept on the bottom bunk together. All right? It's okay. We can handle it. We're cool like that. So he ends up in our bed a lot. But to keep Mama happy, my job is to pick that big kid up and carry him to his room. And I've noticed something through the years. He is getting heavy. And it's awkward. I'm afraid I'm going to decapitate him trying to get through the doorway. I'm just trying not to knock his head off. You know, I'm maneuvering through the doorways, you know, and trying to get him into his room without dropping him. I just can't hold on to him forever. But God can. And he can hold on to you forever. And if you've trusted Jesus, he is going to hold on to you forever. His hands are strong enough to keep us. Jesus said in John 10:27, my sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me, and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand, he says. And my Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hands. He is strong enough to keep us. Jesus, as he's facing death, he wants you to know that there's a person to know. His Heavenly Father, who is loving and who is trustworthy. He wants you to know there's a place to rest. God's hands are big enough to carry you, and they're big enough to, they're scarred enough to remember you, and they're strong enough to keep you. And thirdly, oh, let me say this about God keeping you. Have y'all seen the movie Noah yet? I haven't seen it yet either. Some Christians are like foaming at the mouth, mad about the movie Noah. And some like it. I just haven't seen it because I'm cheap. It's $8. I'm not that interested in seeing it. I'll wait till it's on demand or something, and then I'll watch it. You know, it's a movie, whatever. Here's where I would go berserk in the movie Noah if this happened. In the movie Noah, if I sat down and paid my $8, and well, $20 with my popcorn and drink and all that, if I'm watching the movie Noah, and in the middle of the movie, somebody, Noah or somebody in his family, fell out of the ark and drowned, I would go bananas. I would flip out. That's where I would draw the line. That's where I would like be telling the whole world, do not go see this movie. Because the whole point of the ark is not about Noah. The whole story of the ark is about Jesus. If you're in Jesus, you're never going to perish. The ark pictures that. Now, it really happened, but it's also a picture of Christ. That if those who were in the ark, they might have got knocked around and bounced around, but they never got bounced out of the ark. And so it is with Jesus. You may get knocked around and bounced around. You may stumble around within your relationship with Jesus, but you're never going to get knocked out of your relationship with Jesus. Why? Because his arms, his hands are strong enough to keep you. I want to make sure I said that. Then third, Jesus wants you to know when you're facing death, that there's a possession to surrender. There's something that we give up as we die. And by the way, we are dying. This ought to be being given up now, all the time. Jesus said, Father, into your hands I commit my, what? My spirit. That's that possession to surrender. And by the way, when Jesus said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit, you need to know this. Probably not the first time he ever said that. Only time we know of that he said it, but he probably said it thousands of times. Because that phrase, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit, comes from Psalm chapter 31, verse 5. It was the prayer that Jewish people prayed before they went to bed, before they went to sleep. They would pray. Jewish mothers would teach their babies to pray this prayer before they went to bed. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Could be where our little prayer came from. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. Jesus had been praying this prayer in all likelihood his entire life. And here he is about to breathe his last. And he's focusing on God. He's quoting scripture and he says, I commit my spirit. You know what that tells me? We are a whole lot more. There's a whole lot more to us than just what we see. There's a spirit inside every one of us. I'm not talking about God's Holy Spirit. If you know Jesus today, he's inside of you too. But there is your spirit. See, God created you not with just a body, but he created you with a spirit. That's what makes mankind unique from all of the rest of creation. When the Bible says he created you in his image, this is what we're talking about. Because the Bible says God is spirit. So he created us in his image. That means we're also spirit. It's that invisible part of us that you can't see, that doesn't show up on MRIs or CAT scans or x-rays, but it is the image-bearing part of us that God has given us. Look, let's make this clear. You are not a body with a spirit. You're a spirit with a body. That'll blow your mind, won't it? We're not bodies that have spirits. We are spirits that are just wearing bodies. This is just the clothing for the real me. The real me you can't see. The real me you can't touch. The real me you can't kill. You can do whatever you want to this body, but you can't touch my spirit. It's set apart. It belongs to the Lord. I want to show you a really cool verse of scripture out of 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Because you see, one day my heart's going to stop. My brain's going to stop. My lungs are going to quit working. And my body is going to die. And if you still remember me the day that that happens, I want you to remember what I'm about to tell you. At that very moment, I will be more alive than I've ever been before. My spirit will still go on living, unscathed by the car accident, unscathed by the stroke, unscathed by the cancer, unscathed by the bullet. The spirit's going to go on. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1. You got this? Can you put this up there for me, Brian? Paul says, for we know, watch this, that when this earthly tent we live in is taken down, parentheses, that is when we die and leave this earthly body. Watch. Paul says this body is our earthly tent. He said when this earthly tent we live in, notice he says earthly tent we live in. He's making a distinction. The earthly tent is not you. You live in the earthly tent. Do you see the distinction? When this earthly tent that we live in, this is not me. Thank the Lord this is not me. This is just the tent that the real me is living inside. He says, when that tent is taken down, there's going to be a day it's taken down. Right now, it's functioning because of this spirit inside of me. It's just like if you go pull the frames out from a pup tent, you just watch that thing kind of deflate and fall. That's going to happen to me one day. My spirit's going to depart and be with the Lord, and this thing's just going to cave. And they're going to stick it in the ground, or they're going to incinerate it. I couldn't care less what they do. Whatever's the cheapest, the quickest, the easiest, I don't care. It's just a tent. It's just clothes for the real me. It's just fancy jeans and a t-shirt, really. It's all this is. Fancy jeans. Did y'all get that? That was pretty good, wasn't it? I just caught it. Paul says, when that tent is taken down, we will have a house. A house, not a tent. I mean, be honest. How many of you wanted to be sleeping in a tent at Tanny Hill State Park last Sunday night, Monday morning? How many of you would have signed up for that? Were you crazy? My goodness. Paul says when this tent's taken down, we're going to have a house in heaven, an eternal body made for us by God himself and not with human hands. See, this one is made up of some genetics right now. You know, mom and dad and God all had something to do with this one. But the next one I get's all God. All God. He says, not by human hands, by God himself. This is just a temporary tent to live in. It's just the body that contains the real me, my spirit, my soul. And there's a day coming I'm going to leave this old thing behind. But verse 2 says, and we grow weary in our present bodies. And all God's people said, amen. Y'all should have shouted amen. I'm looking at a bunch of mangy looking tents out here today. Y'all just raggedy looking. These tents look like y'all been just rolling around and getting washed out and flooded and all beat up. Some haggard looking tents. I mean, y'all doing the best you can do with what you got. I understand that. But at the end of the day, it's still a bunch of tents sitting in here. And these tents, tell me if I'm right or wrong. These tents we're living in, they can't keep out sickness, can they? They can't keep out sorrow, can they? They can't keep out death, can they? Just like that little pup tent at Tanny Hill, as fun as it might be for a little while, you'll come to find out it can't keep out all the insects. It can't keep out all the water. It can't keep out all the cold. It can't keep out all the heat. It's not the ideal way to live. Nobody wants to live in a tent forever. I certainly don't want to live in this one forever. Paul goes on and he says, we long to put on our heavenly bodies like new clothing. Are you reading the scripture with me? For we will put on heavenly bodies, amen, and we will not be spirits without bodies. You want to know what heaven's going to be like? You're not going to be little Caspers with a bow and arrow sitting on a cloud with a harp. That's not what it's going to be like. Paul says we're going to be spirits that have a body. And I think it's going to look a lot like the one that you've got right now. People are going to know each other. You're going to know who you are. Some people ask me that question. I believe that's just the reality and the truth of it. We're going to get a new body. And Paul says in verse 4, while we live in these earthly bodies, we groan and we sigh. Like some of y'all doing right now, man, my butt's hurting. I'm tired of sitting in here. You're yawning. You're like, man, I'm aching. I shouldn't have done so much work yesterday. We're groaning. We're sighing. My parents were in the first service. Thank the Lord. They didn't hear me say that. But that's what you were thinking. I wasn't making the news. I was just reporting the news. That's what you're thinking. We groan and we sigh. But it's not that we want to die, he says, and get rid of these bodies that clothe us. Rather, we want to put on our new bodies. There's something in us that says there's got to be better, right? Don't you just feel that in your bones? There's more than this. Sickness ain't right. Sorrow ain't right. Death ain't right. There's got to be something more. We want to put on our new bodies, he says, so that these dying bodies will be swallowed up by life. And verse 5 says, God himself has prepared us for this. Through sending his son Jesus, who gave his life on the cross, he's been preparing us for this. And as a guarantee, watch this, he has given us his Holy Spirit. You put your faith and trust in Jesus while you live in this old tent, and God sends his Holy Spirit to live in the tent with you as a guarantee that the tent is only temporary. He sends his Holy Spirit as a guarantee that one day we're moving out of the tent and we're going home. We're going to have a new body. And then in verse 6, Paul says, so we're always confident. Even though we know that as long as we live in these bodies, as long as we live in these bodies, again, underscoring, these bodies are not us. We live in these bodies. As long as we live in these bodies, we're not at home with the Lord. Verse 7, for we live by believing. And not by seeing. Yes, verse 8, we are fully confident and we would rather be away from these earthly bodies. For then we'll be at home with the Lord. Jesus wants you to know when you're facing death, there is a possession to surrender. It is me, the real me. It is my spirit. And we're facing death every day. Every day we ought to be saying, God, it's not about this. It's not about this. It's not about the stuff. It's not about the physical. It's not about that stuff that's passing away. God, it's about my inner man. It's about your image in me. It's about your glory in me. It's about your purpose in me. It's about my relationship with you. It's about not wasting my life on material, temporary kind of stuff. But God, I am facing death moment after moment after moment, and I want to set my mind not on things below. I want to set my mind on things above. I want to set my mind on things that are going to last, the word of God and the souls of people, my relationship with you, because one day this tent and everything around it, gone, but the real me is going to be in heaven with you forever. I don't want to waste my life on this stuff. Concerned about it. We want to be good stewards of it. Yes. But this is not me. It's not me. We're not bodies with a spirit. We're spirits that have a body. So let me wrap this up and say to you this morning. If you didn't hear me a while ago, let me say it again. Death is coming. For every single one of us, death is coming. And in light of that, I want you to know this morning what Jesus modeled for us as he died. There's a person that you can know today. You can know God as your heavenly Father only through his son Jesus and the work he did on the cross. I would ask you this morning, do you know him? Are you confident today that you've put your faith and trust in Christ alone to rescue you from your sin? Why would you drive away today not knowing that for sure? I want you to know that this morning you have a place to rest, and it's in the hands of God. You can give him that thing that you're worrying about, that circumstance, that situation. Why are you still holding it back from God? Don't you believe today his hands are big enough to carry you? His hands, my gracious, they're scarred enough to remember you. Would you trust him today? And this morning, would you just be reminded that the real you is going to live forever? In light of that, how are you investing your life? Are you spending all your effort, time, and energy on the part of your life that's not going to last? I just wonder how many of my brothers and sisters in Christ this morning would say, you know what, I have been neglecting the inner person, the spirit. My spiritual life is not what it should be. I'm so busy doing the things of this world that I'm not spending the time with the Lord that I need to spend on what really counts. I'm not reading the scripture. I'm not spending time with the Lord in prayer. I'm not in communion with the Lord. And that desperately needs to change. I'm wasting my life because my life is what's on the inside of me. And I'm focused on what's not my life. I've been fooled in thinking that this is real life. And the car I drive and the house I live in and the stuff that I own. But that's just firewood for a day ahead with the Spirit. That's, God, would you turn my heart toward that today? Change my life. You're facing death. And until you're ready to die, you're not ready to live. Jesus shows us in this last statement on the cross how to be ready to die. Are you ready? Until you are, you're really not living. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that we can call you Father because of Jesus. Because he's reconciled us to you. Father, I pray today if there's anybody here that's never trusted in Jesus to save them from their sin, that today would be that day. God, I pray for my brothers and sisters in Christ today who have been so deceived and so caught up and so convinced that this world is really all there is. I mean, they know with their minds this world isn't all there is, but their life says, this must be all there is because this is where I'm going to spend my energy on this stuff. My time is all going to be spent on earthly stuff. God, I don't want to live my life like that. I don't want to waste my life, and I don't want the people that I love and care about to waste their lives because death is coming. And one day we're going to stand in front of you. And for myself and for the people I love, I want us all to hear you say, well done. Good and faithful servant. Help us not to waste our lives, Lord. Holy Spirit, convict your church today of being too earthly. Set us free to focus on the spirit that you've created us to be. The spirit that's to be rightly connected to you. Living for things that are eternal, not temporary. Setting our mind on things above, not below. Help us to trust you wholeheartedly today, God. We pray it in Jesus' name. I want to invite you to stand with us this morning. We want to sing. We want to worship the Lord. And most importantly, we want to respond to God's word. Listen, God's word always comes with a demand. There's always a response that's required from the word of God. And I don't know what your response is supposed to be today, but I know there is supposed to be a response to the word of God. When he said, let there be light, light showed up. When he said, let there be an ocean showed up. There's a response to the word of God. When he said, rise up and walk, the paralyzed man rose up and walked. What is it today that he's saying to you? To you. It demands your response. And I can't respond for you. Nobody else can respond for you. Whatever it is God's saying to you today, it demands a response. And to not respond is disobedience. It would be like the light saying, I'm not showing up. It'd be like the ocean saying, we're going to be a desert instead. It would be like the paralyzed man saying, no thanks. I'd rather keep being paralyzed. See, whatever it is that God is putting before you, it is for your good and for his glory. Why would we not respond? So as we sing, this is your time. This is your time, your opportunity to respond to what God's saying to you. One sermon today, 400 different applications. I don't know what it is for you, but you do. What do you do now? So let's sing. Let's obey the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, worship your holy name.
It's a new day dawning.
The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me,
let me be singing.
Oh,
want you to sing it like this is your last 2 minutes on planet Earth.
And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
his last, and he died for you. See you guys Sunday, Thursday night, 7 o'clock, special time, don't miss it. Friday night, amazing, 7 o'clock, don't miss it. Sunday, I don't have to tell you, amen, because we don't preach funerals on Sundays very often. And we're not going to next week. Amen. God bless you guys.